So yesterday we have seen the total tabs, right? In a user master record, you have total 10 tabs starting from address, then logon data, SNC, defaults. So SNC stands for, I said, secure network communication. When this is activated, user need not enter password to log in into SAP system. So what is the use of this basically? When user need not enter the password, generally the password is like security purpose. So nobody should enter into the system without any password and all details. But when password is not required, when SNC is activated, this could be insecure system. No, anybody can enter into your system and do some damage to system. So what we do is here is, generally we activate this SNC for basis and security guys, generally teams, because these are the only teams who log in into each and every system and perform their tasks. For example, if I compare between two teams, so yesterday we discussed, okay, there is a finance team. Finance team will log in only into finance system to perform their duties. Whereas security team and basis team has to log in into each and every system. They have to enter into HR system, finance system, sales system, ECC, BW, and create user IDs and define authorizations. So that is the reason it is very difficult for a security team or basis team to remember all the passwords of every system. If they forget the password, the normal duties, their duties, they cannot do. So to facilitate them or to make them easier, we will enable this SNC feature for only the support users, like technical users like basis and security. Nobody else will be given to this SNC is activated. Okay, so there is a separate configuration for it. It is not required generally. In interview, if they ask you, tell the purpose, like this is used for not when SNC is activated and user need not enter the password, directly he can log in into system. It is only enabled for two teams. Okay. And those two teams are security and basis teams, nothing else. So that is the use of SNC. Coming to defaults, here you need to enter the date format, decimal notation, time format, printer details, time zone, so etc. will be defined. These are the features which we define under the defaults tab, and they are common to every user. So you don't define different date formats to different users. Every user, if there are 1,000 users in your organization, every user will have the same date format, same decimal notation, time format, printer details, time zones. Printer may vary from user to user. Suppose if users are spread across different locations like Chennai, Hyderabad, so Hyderabad users have access to a different printer, whereas Chennai users will have access to a different printer. So except the printer and other some whichever necessary, remaining all details will be similar. Okay, so that is the use of this defaults tab. And then parameters tab. So this is required only, just enter it only when it is requested, nothing else. Enter these details only when requested. So tab wise we are discussing now, and then parameters, roles. So this is where actually the roles are assigned. Roles is nothing but assign authorizations to roles. So we can assign authorizations here to any user. And profiles are also same concept. It also gives access. They also provide access. They are interlinked with the roles, and we'll discuss them in detail in the next class, how they are interlinked. And there is a limit also. To one user, we cannot assign more than 3 to all profiles. Or you can say maximum number of profiles that can be assigned to one user, that number is 312. So groups, actually we have seen the user group already in the logon data. Here we have user group again. There is a repeated, this group is repeated. If user belongs to multiple groups, just enter the extra groups here under this tab. So if user belongs to only one group, then we don't have any issue. We will define it under the logon data tab, under the user group, under logon data tab. So if user has any extra groups, then only you can define here, otherwise not required. So here do not enter any details. It is by default the data is filled. So this is a description about each and every tab. So the last tab, I said it is related to licensing of users. SAP is like, it is license dependent. When you buy the SAP license software, that is dependent on number of users in the system. If there are 1000 users, the cost will vary. If there is 5000 users, the cost will vary accordingly. So this license tab will give a report to user SAP, how many users are being created in SAP system and what are their roles and responsibilities. Like, they generally categorize users as developers, administrators, etc. So they are bothered of like this licensing of users, like admins, comma, developers, etc. So they categorize users as admins. Total how many users are there as admins, and how many users are acting as developers. So that data is stored here in the license data tab. So let me show you that once. So here, when I go to SU01, yesterday we have written on my ID Mirja S display. So these are the tabs which we are discussing: address, login data, SNC, defaults, parameters, roles, profiles, groups. So I said extra groups have to be defined here. Personalization. This is by default, this data will be filled. Do not, you don't enter any data here. License data. Here you can see the different types of licenses we have. Like basis means admin team, developer means the development ABAP team, and based on the module you have different licenses. So whenever a user is created or you have a limited user licenses, this data has to be entered here. Suppose if you are a basis user, then you need to put as a basis here. Go to change mode and define him as a basis user. So then version, what is a version? No special version. Save it. So like this, you need to enter the details. If in your company they are focusing on the licenses, some companies buy unlimited licenses. So when they have unlimited licenses, don't worry about the license, do not fill anything here. So just only especially big companies, huge multi-billionaire companies, do not care about the license, because they buy umbrella licenses, because irrespective of the number of users, you can use the software. So in that cases, we don't give any preference to the license tab. So that are the total tabs, 10 tabs: address, login data, SNC, defaults, parameters, roles, profiles, groups, personalization, and license data. Right. Now coming onto the main tabs, we have actually already seen, this is for create, change, if you want to modify any data inside related to the data, user data, that could be password, that could be something else, etc. You can do it here. Display mode, just to see the data. This is for delete. When I click on delete, system is confirming once again, do you want to delete user? If I click yes, the user is gets deleted. No. This is copy. If I want to create another user with the same data, like same defaults, same parameters, same roles, address cannot be same. So when I click on copy, system will ask me, for example, this one. I am keeping creating one more ID. You can see the address part is not chosen here. So why the address part is not chosen? Reason being, first name, last name will vary for every user. Email ID will vary for every user. Mobile number will vary. Address will vary. So that is the reason address part is not copied. Remaining everything else is copied. Address and then the password. Password of other user, earlier user is not copied. You need to declare a new password for this particular user. And then now you can say, if you see the data, address data, as I did not fill any address data, the system will pick up the user ID itself as the last name, because last name is a mandatory field, it has to fill some data and then it is saved. Okay, so whenever you copy a ID, what is not copied? Two things are not copied. So the things is, one is address data, and second thing is the password. Password is not copied into the new ID. Okay, that is about copy. This is lock and unlock. When I click on lock, it first shows the status, and then here we have a lock symbol here. Click on lock. It is both same. Now the user ID is locked. How do you check that? Under login data tab, here you can see the status as user is locked. This is the password, and here you can see the status is locked. And when I unlock now again, click on again the same symbol. Now it is showing the status now first. Locked by system manager. So click on unlock. Now you go the check on the status inside. It is not shown here, status. So whether user is locked or not, you can know in two ways. One is go to display mode, check under login data tab above password if there is a status for locking, or click on the lock symbol. This is the status of the user. User is not locked, and this is for lock symbol. Okay, so this is about lock, and the last tab icon is for change password. So you can do again change password in two ways. Go to edit mode, go to login data, change the password, type two times, twice. But instead of going inside, I can directly do it from outside, clicking on this icon, change password. Now system will ask you to change, type the password, new password. So you can type the new password now here and then save it, and that password will be communicated to user. Okay, so these are the total 7 icons you have. As soon as you come inside S201 command, and when you click on create or display, how many tabs you see inside are 10 tabs. So you need to remember each and every tab of this screen, because you have seen this screen almost more than 1000 times so far, as per the experience you are keeping in your. Right. So now coming to extra details, like regarding the user. Yesterday we have seen under login data tab, we have something called as an user type. There are 5 types of users, and let us see in detail what is the use of different types of users now. Dialog, system, communication, reference and service. Okay, let me show in the document wise. So here these are the user types. So these are the user types. First one is dialog. So it is a default user type, and we call that also as an interactive user. Interactive meaning is what? So when you enter a command to a system, system will respond to you. Means you are interacting with the system. So you enter the commands, system responding to you based on the command you enter. So that concept is called as interactive user. Okay, and for this user, password parameters are applied. So what do you mean by password parameters are applied? There are some parameters in SAP which will control the password, like minimum length of the password, then some special characteristics what you need to enter in the password, minimum capital letters you need to enter into the password, etc. So something they are called as password expiry date. Suppose if you put password expiry date as 3 months, after every 3 months system will ask you for regenerating. You need to reset your password on your own. So after 3 months, system will prompt you to change your password. If you don't change your password after 3 months, that password, earlier password expires and you need a new password to log in again. So all such parameters will be applied for this user's called dialog. And then the last one is GUI login is allowed. So GUI login. So GUI stands for graphical user interface. And this is a software which we use it to log in, right? I have shown you how to log in through GUI already. So let me show you once again. This is the GUI software. When you click on the system, log on. This is a system, BW system. Click on log on. And then system will ask you user ID and password. It's not responding. New screen, new screen. This is the screen. So you enter the user ID and password here, and then you log in. So this is called as GUI login. So for dialog users, this login is allowed. That is what I'm saying. GUI login is allowed. Okay, so these are the characteristics of dialog user. Now whom do we define as dialog? All employees of the organization, irrespective of what department he belongs to. All employees of the organization. Irrespective of this department. Including IT company employees and the support end user employees, every employee will be defined as a dialog user. service. So the second type of ID, this is used for multiple dialog logons. So multiple dialog logons in the sense, you log in into system as one dialog user, and then you can use this particular service ID to log in into, again you will log in into another into system as different people. So let me show you diagrammatically. So if this is your system, so when you log in inside, so you can log in with your dialog ID, and inside using this service IDs, this is service ID 1, service ID 2, so this is dialog 1 D1, and this is service 1 and service 2. Okay, so using these IDs, same dialog user can log in now and act as a two different IDs now. He can act as a two different users. So like this, you can have n number of service IDs, and then he can act as a different users. So this is the purpose of a service ID. So using service ID, a dialog user can log in into system as a multiple users. So that is the definition I wrote here, used for multiple dialog logons. So the best example what we can take here is firefighter ID concept. So we have a concept of firefighter ID, FFID concept in GRC. So that we'll come to know when, if you are going for GRC in detail, how that works and all those things. Now coming to service ID, password parameters are not applied. So the main difference between dialog and here, password parameters are applied, whereas here the password parameters are not applied. Service ID means though no expiry of the password, no restrictions regarding the password, and then even firefighter ID can log in through GUI. GUI login allowed. Okay, so these are the second category example. So we define all firefighter IDs in GRC, and another example would be generally test IDs will be defined as service IDs. The main reason of defining service IDs is the password will not expire for those IDs if you define as service IDs. And the third one, coming to system, these type of IDs are used for internal communication. These IDs are used for internal communication. Password parameters are not applied for this. GUI login not allowed. So nothing is possible for this. So what exactly mean by internal communication? Suppose this is a system. If you want to communicate internally from one place to other, within a system if you want to communicate, the ID being used is nothing but the system ID, internal communication. For this, the password parameters are not applied and the GUI login is not allowed. So if you are defining one ID as a system ID, you cannot log in into GUI using this system ID. So background jobs, the main purpose of the system IDs is background jobs. There is a concept called as background jobs. So are scheduled using this system IDs, and also internal RFCs. So there is a concept of internal RFCs. Okay, so that is the use of system IDs, used for background job scheduling or scheduled. Using this system IDs, and the other application where we use are internal RFCs. So you will actually use this, we'll use this all the IDs when we actually go into subject, when we deal with the concept of background jobs. I'll show you how this ID will be used. And communication ID, the fourth type, used for external communication. So the basic difference between system and communication IDs is it is used for internal communication, whereas this is used for external communication. External communication means this is one system and this is another system. This is another system. So the communication between these two. Okay? The communication between these two. So these two. So this communication is nothing but external communication. So outside system, with whichever system you do, so that particular thing is called as an external. Within a system you do communicate, that is called as internal communication. So communication IDs are used for external communication. Password parameters are not applied for these ID also, and GUI login is also not allowed. So if you declare an ID as system or communication, you cannot login into system using GUI though you know the password. Okay, then how these IDs are used. So currently you will not understand better than this. Once we go into subject and I'll show you, so then you will be able to map it or relate it. So as of now, just remember the types, user types, and regarding the logins, GUI login is allowed or not, and password parameters are applied or not. Reference user, very important from interview point of view. So as I told you, this ID, there is a limit for number of profiles we can assign to one user, and that limit is nothing but 3 to 12 profiles. So when there is a limit, and when the limit reaches for a user and user needs extra access, so then we go for defining this reference ID, user for providing extra access to dialog IDs. User for providing extra access to dialog IDs. So let me show you how to provide extra access. Suppose modify this ID. Under roles tab, you can see there is a heading called as reference user for additional rights. Here click F4, you will see any data is available regarding a reference user. It says no values. So now I'll create a reference user. So first let me explain diagrammatically. Suppose this is user 1 and this is another user who is a reference user. He is a dialog user and this guy is a reference user. So to this user there is 2 roles assigned. Whereas for this user, two more roles are assigned. So this is role 1. Role 2, role 3, and role 4. So when I link my dialog ID to the reference ID, this dialog user can use role 1, role 2, and role 3, and role 4 as well. So dialog user can use his roles assigned to him plus the roles of reference user also. So what I said is when this limit is reached, that when this user his limit is reached, like 3 to 12 roles and profiles are assigned to dialog user, then we can define reference user and assign extra roles if required. So this is an imaginary condition, actually never achieved. So in real time scenarios, a user achieving this limit 3 to 12 profiles is imaginary condition. If it is reaching 3 to 12 profiles, means security is very bad in a position. Means they did not create the roles properly. They don't have a proper proper roadmap of creating as roles and etc. So that is a very bad implementation if it is exceeding 3 to 12 profiles. So you can interview, you can say that this concept is never used, but theoretically the purpose is to provide extra access to dialog user. So that is the purpose of this reference user. So this we can define here. So let me create one reference user now. REF underscore MIR ZAS create. So here last name, mandatory fields, I am just filling the mandatory fields, last name and then the password. This should be reference. Password can be deactivated because you don't log in with this ID. Now you assign some roles here. So this ID has two roles. Now I'll go to the normal ID, my dialog ID, modify, roles tab. Here I put my reference user. This is reference underscore majors. Save it. So now according to this concept, this Mirza S1 has access to one role, whereas a reference user has access to two roles. So in total, this Mirza S1 can have access to three roles, one plus the two roles of reference user. So this is the main purpose of reference user. So password is generally deactivated when access limits, this is the condition when we go for this. When its access limit is 312 profiles is reached, no password required, cannot log in through GUI. As there is no password, we cannot log in through GUI, or we don't allow the reference user to log in directly. This is a dummy ID we are creating. So these are the different types of users, very important from interview point of view. Definitely you will get on one or two questions from this topic in interview point of view. They can ask you what is the difference between dialog and service, or system and communication, or what is the use of reference user. So anyhow, I'll be providing you some FAQs. You can prepare for those FAQs. So any doubts close so far till now here? Right. The next important thing is called as, Monica, do you have any doubt?
Nothing.
Okay. So next important concept is change documents. So what do you mean by change documents? Change docs, to see the changes done to user in a time interval, in a certain time interval. So the path is go to SU01T code and then information tab and change documents for user. So here this is SU01 command, go to information, change documents for users. Execute now. You will see when this ID was created. So let me put another ID. So Mirza S, you can see here. This ID was created on 10th February by Praveen ID. User created. And then around 6:27 time according to, that is showing the system time, not the actual timing. And at 6:33, the Mirza user herself logged in and did what? Changed the password. And if you see the Mirza S1, today we logged her many times. You can see the lock also. Praveen has locked changed. Old value was 0, which was not locked, and now it went to 64. He has changed lock value from 0 to 64. 64 means administrator lock. And then again he unlocked the user. From 64 he made it to 0. That means the ID has been unlocked. So like this, there are different types of locks we have. So those locks are documented here. So these are the different types of locks, user locks. So 0 stands for not locked. 32 stands for global lock, which is related to CUA concept. So we'll discuss in CUA when we come to CUA. C64 administrator lock. Now you can see this ID value is 64 here. So when I lock as a security admin, that is called as an administrator lock. And 128 is like incorrect logon locks. Incorrect logon locks. When user is entering a wrong password for minimum number of times, that could be 3 times, 4 times or 5 times, the user gets locked himself. So that particular thing is called as an incorrect logon locks. So 3 types of locks: global lock, administrator lock, and incorrect logon locks. So this will be value shown in the database tables like this when you go to change documents. So you cannot see anywhere else, only in the change documents you can see. So very important step. So whatever you do, it is being recorded. So that is very dangerous, I am saying. Unless and until you have a ticket, you have some request or you have a mail, only then go and change anything. Anything it could be. It could be locking, unlocking, it could be what you say, password resets. Don't do any activity based on the oral communication. Because if you do anything on oral communication, tomorrow there is no proof that that person has said to you. Unless and until you have recorded the voice, and again he may say that that is not my voice, why all this nonsense. So basically, if you are going to do any changes in the system, ask for a mail or ask for a ticket. If there is any ticketing tool, please raise a ticket in the ticketing tool, or ask him to drop a mail from his official mail ID what change has to be done. And don't forget, if there are approvals to be taken, please take the approvals first and then do the change. So if there is a process, stick to the process. So at least when you join for the first 6 months, you should be sticking to the process. If you don't stick to the process, you will be always in a trouble. So at least for first minimum 6 months. After 6 months, you will come to know the project landscape and project behavior, people's behavior. So based on that, you can decide whether to follow the process or not. But for first 6 months to 1 month, 1 year, you join in the organization, stick to the process and do the tasks as per the process. Don't deviate any process. So as I told you, there could be some procedure like this, like I told you yesterday, for user creation, you need a manager approval and then role owner approval and security team, it then comes security team. If some user directly walks to you, he may be a close friend of you, he may be your relative, whomever it may be. He'll directly come to you and he'll ask you, please create my ID. So just slowly or softly say him, please provide me access form with manager approval and role owner approval, because there is a process defined here. So don't try to deviate the process. So if you are deviating the process, you will be in trouble. Okay, when you are in trouble, nobody will help you. Nobody will come to you as well. Right. So there are some standard users coming which are created in SAP. So these are the standard users. Some of the standard users I have listed down here with the passwords also, and in which clients they are created. So user IDs which exist in SAP system by default after installation. Initial login into the system would be used with these IDs, would be done with these IDs. Okay, so basis team first time logs in into system using these IDs only, with especially SAP star. So SAP star password is pass, small pass, no P capital, normal pass, or this is the number you have to enter, 0607-1992. It is created by default in all the clients. And then the second ID is DDIC. This is the password and these are the clients, 000 and 001. SAP CPIC is another password, which the password is admin, created in these two clients. And the last ID, early watch, password is support, and it is created in only 066. So these are the standard IDs which are generally created in your system once you install the software. So basis team will be the owner, take the ownership of these IDs, because they are the people who logs in with these IDs and they do some specific tasks related to with these IDs, like monitoring the CCMS activities. You have many activities, monitoring activities which they do, and these are the IDs being used for those monitoring activities and all those things. So they will take the ownership of these IDs. They will change the passwords so that other users cannot misuse these passwords, logging in and all those things. And I have listed down some facts here. So user ID maximum length 12 characters, yesterday we discussed this. User ID naming convention differs from organization to organization. Like a combination of first name and last name will be taken when you are creating an ID. If this is the name of the user, Balatharan Murali, so you will take a Bala from the first Balatharan, and then from Murali I have taken the first two characters MU. So that is the user ID that is created in the system. Now whoever user joins the organization, this will be the same concept they will be using. And maximum number of profiles assigned to one user, I have been repeatedly saying it is 312. Mandatory fields while creating the user ID are last name and password. User related tables are like, we'll discuss this later in more detail, just I'm giving a hint here. So they start with USR star, so tables and USR, these are the some tables, we'll discuss them in detail in another class. All the tables we'll see in one class, so don't worry about the tables. Okay, so this is all about user administration. So yesterday's class and today's class is completely related to user and the questions and all those things. So go through these two documents, yesterday's class and today's class. So come to me if any doubts on Monday. So tomorrow we'll take off and we'll restart on Monday again, same time. Right? So meanwhile, if you have any doubts, let me know now with the today's topic regarding the user types, especially, and then the locks and standard users, even the tabs. No doubts?
Yeah, no doubts.
Okay, thank you, Monica. So,
thank you, sir.
So I'll be closing this.
Sir, actually,
yeah. Go ahead.
Can you send me the attachments to my mail ID instead of Rupesh?
Okay.
Can you make it down my?
Yeah, you can just.
Yeah,
do you have my number?
No, I don't. Ah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, just text to my message to my mobile. I'll just send you that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Thank you so much.
So anybody else?
Hey Sridhar, this is Gaurav here.
Yeah Gaurav.
Actually, I just noticed that the tab over there was SNC. Actually, I kind of missed that part. Can you please repeat that? What is that for?
So SNC is for when this is activated, what happens is user need not enter the password.
Okay.
So when I click on like this login generally, system is asking for password, right? User ID password.
Right.
This page is skipped and you will directly enter into system. Okay, to avoid asking of password, we will activate SNC.
So any benefit of doing that?
Yeah, generally we activate only for security and basis, guys. The reason is security and basis are the two teams who has to log in into each and every system and do the tasks.
Okay.
Remaining other teams, for example, if you take finance team, finance team has to log in only into finance system. They know they need not bother about remembering of the passwords. But whereas security and basis teams are the only two teams which have to remember entire landscape passwords. If they forget the passwords, the main task of password resets, your role creation, user creation will be on hold. So
the credentials are not same across the board?
No.
Or they have different password for different systems?
You can put the same password, but problem is as you proceed for 6 months, 1 year, at the end of the 1 year, the passwords will get changed automatically. You have to reset your password every 3 months once.
Okay. So oh, that's the system requirement.
Yeah, system requirement. Okay. So one system you lately log in, so it will lately ask for reset of password. One system you early login, you do early login and it will ask for early logins of reset of password. So at the end of the year, though initially you set only one password for all the systems, at the end of the year you will end up with ending different passwords.
Okay, okay, great. Okay, that makes sense. And the other question I have is like apart from GUI login, can we access the system some other way?
Into backend system, GUI is the only way.
Okay. Okay,
but there is something else which is called as front end, like EP, enterprise portal, like a website look we have. So for that login, you will just log in like your Gmail or a Facebook.
Oh, okay.
That is there. So, it is called as enterprise portal.
EP, okay. Okay, that clears my doubt.
Right. So I'll be sending you this. I'll be sending you these videos. You can go through them once again.
Oh yeah, that would be helpful too. Yep.
Okay. Right then, Gaurav, you to send your email ID to my mobile ID so that I can send you these documents and.
Yeah, you bet. I'll send you a text right away.
Right. Anything else, guys?
This is all for me, though. Good. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. Right then. So tomorrow is off. We'll meet on Monday again. Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah, okay.